Good morning, everybody. It is great to see you on this Sunday. We hope you made it in safely. There's a lot of rain. I mean, I would say we're usually not used to that, but I think this year we're used to that. We basically live in Washington or something. So we're glad you made it in here safely. Let's continue with our welcome with Pastor Trevor.
Let's stand together. Let's get started. If you are wondering where the third graders are, they're across the way in the sanctuary. So if you are here for the third grade to sing, you can exit now and second grade, you can make your way across and hear them sing. But today we have a beautiful day. We have our new members being welcomed into our congregation today. We got great songs, decent message. Let's get started. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing.
Let's praise his name. Put our hands together this morning. You're ready to sing out.
All praise in the valley. All praise on the mountain. All praise when I'm sure. Praise when I'm down.
My soul,
praise.
You guys sound great this morning. My name is Ariel, and I'm so glad to be worshiping and singing with you guys this morning. We got another song. It's called Awake My Soul. And there's a line that says that we need to sing aloud. And I love that line because when I think about how good God is, when I think about who He is, how can we stay quiet? Like we just sang. We can't keep it inside. Let's not stay quiet. So I want to encourage you to not stay quiet this morning. We're going to sing out loud together. Amen? So if you sing it, if you know it, sing it with me.
Sing His praise aloud. We sing His praise.
see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children. And that is what we are. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. All who have this hope in Him purify themselves just as He is pure. Do you confess that you have sinned against God and against your neighbor? We confess together. Almighty Father, we confess that we have sinned. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that He appeared so that He might take away our sins, and in Him is no sin. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. We're to continue in worship, and today we celebrate Spanish Heritage Day as we join in worship and be blessed in a congregation of such diversity. We sing together and sing with us as we sing.
Death could not hold me, but seemed
thank you and we praise you this morning. We thank you for the powerful, mighty name of Jesus Christ that we get to sing out in a multitude of languages, Lord, and cultures that you have blessed us with as people of your kingdom. Lord, we know that Christ redeems us this morning. He appears to us as our rock, our salvation, who walked in our shoes and showed us his light that shines in each of us. Lord, we thank you that we get to sing out these praises and proclaim your name, Lord, the majestic name of Christ this morning. Lord, we ask you to continue to open up our hearts and our minds as we continue to worship you, as we hear from your gospel message in the word of the Lord. In your name, we pray and we say, amen. Why don't you have a seat this morning as we welcome our lay reader to read our scripture.
The epistle reading is from 1 John, the third chapter, verses 1 through 7. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that he appeared so that he might take away our sins, and in him is no sin. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him or known him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel comes from Luke, the 24th chapter, verses 36 to 49. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." This is the gospel of the Lord. I invite you to share the peace of Christ by extending a warm welcome to those sitting near you.
Let's see if we remember this. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Very good. You know, in Luke's resurrection account, It's the women who go to the tomb on Sunday morning. And if you remember, the stone is rolled back and there's two men in dazzling clothes. They announce that Jesus was raised. The women return. They report the news to the disciples and to the rest who are there. But their report seems to be a bit of like crazy talk, and it wasn't believed. So Peter and John, of course, running faster. Thank you, Jason. Another star for the crown there, brother. Ran to the tomb. They confirm that it's empty. And on that same day, two from the group of followers of Jesus are going to Emmaus, and they encounter, but they don't recognize Jesus. And they're walking with him, right? And they're expressing their disappointed hope that Jesus would have been the one to redeem Israel. But Jesus explains how everything that happened was necessary according to Scripture. And then the two invite Jesus to spend the night with them. But during the meal, when Jesus is blessing and breaking the bread, their eyes are open. They realize it's him. He vanishes from their sight. And they rush all the way back to Jerusalem and report to the believers and the disciples there. And this is where our reading picks up today that was just read for us. Now, this seems to be the same late Sunday meeting that Jesus had with the 11 that was described in John 20 that we looked at last week. And in his gospel, you'll remember, John specifically wrote that Jesus appeared to them when the doors were shut. It seems that Jesus suddenly was there, and the disciples, he was standing on his feet in the midst of a closed room, no opening of the door, he was just there, and he greets them with that, "Peace be with you." But remember that this is more than just a greeting, this peace. This has been a repeated theme throughout the Gospels, especially in the Gospel of Luke, where the hymns of Zechariah, the singing of the angels, and Simeon in those first two chapters of Luke are all about how peace has come in Jesus. And here, at the end of Luke's Gospel, the first word of the risen Jesus to his disciples is peace. And it promises not only that immediate relief of fear, but also the larger part of this resurrection life that we have now in Christ and how we are supposed to be. See, these words, "peace be with you," bring new meaning. Now that Jesus has risen from the dead, true peace has come between God and man and even amongst ourselves. And if you're wondering, what does that mean, true peace? It means we have been made right with God. By Christ's death and resurrection, the cost of sin has been paid. The power of death has been defeated, and the final say that will be spoken over you when you stand before the Lord Almighty, you will not be condemned as a sinner like you deserve. Instead, what will be said is, "This one is forgiven, this one is saved, this one is mine." And you, believer of Christ Jesus, will be in the presence of the God who is the God of the living forever and ever. Amen. And he comes back to us, not just so that we're excited about salvation, but that because of his power and because of what he has done for us, that we would become lovers of God and lovers of others. For his peace enables us to rightly live now in relationship with one another. In fact, he tells us that he wants us to be known by our love, to serve each other joyfully and generously. For if we have now been made right with God, sinners that we are, he bids us to do as he himself did and love one another. And there's one more thing I want to say about this. Peace be with you. I don't think it's an accident that this is what Jesus says when he appears, because he says it to each one of us. He says to each one of us, "Peace be with you." Truly. This isn't just a throwaway line. He says it to your heart. "Peace be with you." It's the way that we need to start our day, saying, "I have peace in Jesus. His peace is with me." When we close our eyes before we go to sleep, we say, "I have peace with Jesus. He is with me." When the stress and the anxiety starts to rise, we hear these words from Jesus, "Peace be with you." And he invites us to trust that. Because I don't know about you, but I think we all need a little peace right now. Not a no-war peace. Not a no pain or suffering or loss will ever come your way peace. Not a wave of his hand and all your problems disappear peace. But the peace that rests deep in your heart. The one where Jesus says, "Look and see. The very worst that can happen was done to me. And yet here I stand among you declaring peace. You are mine forever. And nothing will ever separate you from me." And he has this way of cutting through all the noise of the world and what's going on in our lives and promises peace. Because not only is he the giver of peace, but he truly is the peacemaker. But the disciples hear it and they're frightened, as you can see. They think it's a ghost. Now, for my Twilight fans out there, you'll want to know that while some scholars point out that Jesus says that his body had flesh and bones, do you see that there? A ghost does not have flesh and bones. You're thinking, well, I believe the saying actually, Jesus, is that they don't have flesh and blood. Is that correct? Now, perhaps the idea of the resurrection of body of Jesus, people are saying, well, then that means when we're resurrected, we won't have blood. That's just why I mentioned you Twilight fans. But let me slow you down here. It's more likely that Jesus has flesh and blood and bones here because blood couldn't be felt, right? Bones can be touched. And another reason that I'm going to elaborate on in a second. And again, if you were Team Jacob, this doesn't apply to you. As you can see in the next, though, and I did some research on this because I'm just going to go on this point because I thought it was interesting. We got time. I did some research on this. And according to scholars, there were certain tests that you could do in antiquity to test if what you were seeing was really a ghost. And I'm sure, of course, you know, you could do these nowadays too. But anyway, in antiquity, to check for a ghost, there were big four things. Ready? One, you would check the extremities where bones were. So, you know, you see a ghost, you walk up. If you can touch hands and feet, not a ghost. You also had to make sure that the feet were on the ground. Feet on the ground, not a ghost. Teeth, not a ghost. I don't know that one. And then eating food. So if you could touch it, if it's eaten, not a ghost. Now, I don't know what that means about Slimer for my Ghostbuster fans and the validity of that movie for you now, but I'm going to press past it because in all seriousness, Jesus is displaying his wounded hands and his feet to the disciples because in this, Jesus is both establishing his identity and his bodily existence. That it was in a transformed state, this same body that he had before the cross. The same body that was in the tomb is the one that was standing before them, which is remarkable to consider. That the resurrection body of Jesus retained the wounds that he had received in his suffering and crucifixion. And people listed all sorts of possible reasons for this, so that when he stood before the disciples, they would recognize him, so that it could be the object of eternal amazement for the angels as they would look and see the one who was pierced. Some said it was his trophy of the great work that he did to defeat death. Others that it served as his perpetual intercession for us, that he would walk before God and say, no, this one, I covered this one's sin. But either way here, Jesus assures us that he is real. That this is his physical body, though of a different order, of course, than our own bodies. Not a ghost or a spirit, but a risen body that is now a spiritual body. And even more significant than the proofs that he gives here is the words that he speaks himself when he says, I am myself. It is I. That's that same Greek, ego ami, I am, that is all throughout John's Gospels. He's saying this is not something new. I am the same Jesus doing the same things that I have always done so many times before. And so with seven verses that Luke gives to emphasize the physicality of the resurrected Jesus, there can be no doubt that this is a flesh and bones Jesus, not a ghost. But when you dig a little deeper, the main point is even more profound than just the fact that he had a physical resurrected body. It's that Jesus truly is real, and that Jesus is truly alive. And if you move from the head to the heart for just a moment. I know that some of us know what that's like to have thought that you lost someone, that they were gone, but then you get to hold them again, and how amazing that feels. And on the other side, there are the loved ones who know that we won't see that person again until Christ returns or till we join them in heaven. But this is our hope. No matter how bad we want that, how much we pray, Lord Jesus, come quickly, return. Let us see and be with our loved ones again. When those feelings come, it is the peace that he gives and the promise that he makes to you that sustains your heart. Because when he says, peace be with you, you have it. It is yours. Text finishes with Jesus eating some fish that they gave him, and then he reminds them that everything that has happened to him happened in order to fulfill Scripture. So here, not only does Jesus open their minds to the truth that all Scripture is centered on him and focused on him, like he said to those Pharisees, you're reading those Scriptures, these are the very Scriptures that testify about me. He's also understanding, opening their understanding to the proper way for the disciples of the crucified and risen Jesus to now read those Scriptures. They read them messianically and missionally. They read them messianically because they know without a doubt that what they are to preach now is Christ crucified and Christ risen. And then missionally, now they are to go. See, the Apostle Paul understood this, which is why in the end of Acts, at Acts chapter 26, he says, to this day I've had the help that comes from God, and so I stand here testifying to both small and great, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses and Psalms said would come to pass, that the Christ must suffer, and that by being the first to rise from the dead, he proclaims light both to our people and to the Gentiles. That's the going. See, Jesus wanted them to understand that the cross was never some unfortunate obstacle that he had to hurdle. It was a necessary part of God's redemptive plan for all of mankind. And it would be in the name of this risen Jesus that repentance and remission of sins is given. And so I think, for as emotional as it is and how badly we may want to see a risen Jesus, confirming the physical reality of Jesus in this section is never Luke's ultimate goal. Because Jesus says, I'm opening your minds so that the scriptural fulfillment, which is necessary and informant and confirms everything that you believe about me and is true. And because of it, we don't miss how important that suffering, death, and resurrection of Jesus is to understand what God was doing from the very beginning to bring us back to him, to make us right with him, to have peace with him. Because what you see in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection is the entire plan of a God who loves you so much that you can assume that he formed this world with those holes in his hand already. Knowing who you are and what you would do, he said, it was worth it to me to come. That's opening the minds of the disciples. That's why we confess that we believe that he rose from the dead, that we believe in the resurrection of a body, that we believe in the forgiveness of sins. Because we too, even though we haven't seen him with our own eyes or touched him with our own hands, have experienced the presence of Jesus. We say those things not just because we're affirming some ancient doctrine, but we say them because we are to bear witness to the marvelous truth of what Jesus has done for each one of us. It's why he tells them and us, you are witnesses of these things. Forgiveness of sins, resurrected Christ Jesus, sending you out aren't just words. This is a call for each one of us to spread this gospel. He looks at the apostles and says, this is your work. Take it to all nations. Take it to all people. In reality, this means that what was supposedly just for one nation, or really one man's family, Abraham's family, right, the Jews, is for all people, all nations, all families. When he says that you are witnesses of these things, he is now giving you a task. He is asking you to continue. Continue what was seen by the 12 and proclaim it into your family. It has moved from just being some out of touch thing that is just for one nation and one people into all people to be brought into your families. And I think that is one of the most important and profound things that we have to hear. That this gospel of Jesus is directly for you and for the ones that God brings into your lives. It's not about race or gender or wealth, but it's about unity and being made new in the one who is Christ Jesus. That is a message that still needs to be preached because of how real and how alive Jesus is even today. He looks and sees you, and he sends you to be his witness, to open eyes so that others can see Jesus. He sends you out to serve so that others can experience the touch of Jesus. He sends you out to provide food that satisfies eternally that hole that is in us, not some passing fad. And he sends each one of you out to experience this new life of what it means to be his witness, to walk with him and to know him and to have real life in Jesus. And when he promises you peace is with you, it is yours to bear witness that while everything may fall apart, what we have is not taken away, not by violence, not by death, not by anything. For the peace that we have is ours forever. And there is no mistake. He's sending you to speak that peace into the hearts and lives of your family, your friends, your coworkers, and each person you come in contact with. Amen. Let's stand together and confess this faith that we share that unites us in our belief in the Lord. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven. Life everlasting. Amen. We unite our hearts as one as we pray. Almighty God, you make known to us the path of life. As your Son opened the minds of the disciples to understand the scriptures, enable us by your Spirit to hear them and to put your word into action, to mark, learn, and inwardly digest what you teach us, Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, we thank and praise you for those we are welcoming as new members into the body of Christ at St. John's today, here in Walker Hall and over in the sanctuary as well. Equip us all for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and become mature in the knowledge of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we give thanks for the marriage of Lindsay Trujillo and Jonathan Mourner, son of Leah, and Tim Mourner, grandson of Charlotte. Give them and all spouses wisdom and devotion in the ordering of their common life, that each may be to the other a strength in need, a counselor in perplexity, a comfort in sorrow, and a companion in joy. Lord, in your mercy. God of all comfort, you have compassion on those who are afflicted. Remember and have mercy on all those in need of your healing and deliverance, especially the Appleby family, Candy Ariza, Ryan Bartholomew, Ken Bourne, Amy and Lee Bramson, Don and Nancy Brooks, Marlene Burian, Larry Bush, Gwen Clark, Peggy Sue Costello, Mary Ann Covington, Angelo Cruz, Leslie Dobernick, Alan Dume, Angela Biang Gass, Otis Glazer, Thea Glenn, Debbie Gunther, Thomas Hanscom, Andy Hirsch, Austin Yerugi, Jack Yerugi, Linda Johnson, Sally Keller, Michelle Kiley, the Kim family, Vicky King, Luke Kolb, Kathy Laurel, George Lawyer, Colleen and Joe McDonald, Xavier Meza, Ragney Nelson, Jeff Oden, Patrick Pattinson, Alan Primrose, Ken Roberts, Jeff Sardo, Millie Seaton Arroyo, Tom Sorensen, Todd and Brenda Thames, the Tumser family, Mark Tway, Nola Vroom, Heather Walk, Jeff and Christy Whitted, Janice Zabel, Roxanne Zimmerman, Brianna Attaway, Sarah Osborne, Rudy Barba, Kristen Berry, Olivia Biel, Patrick Burke, Tisak Sabalos, Jim Covington, Scarlett Cruz, Dorothy Dale, Mikey Enriquez, Mike Farina, Gail Forbes, Judy Fukuda, Annie Bates Gansky, Jim Hetherington, Carol Holmes, Vaughn Holt, Todd Peterson, Brandon Reynolds, Raina Ross, Gina Santagnanello, Bob Schluter, Megan Small, Frank Soto, Dave Tibbs, Steve Tyler, Denise Wyrick, Howard and Louise Worthington, George Son, Heather Zelenka, and those we silently name before you now. Lord, in your mercy. Everlasting God, you are close to the brokenhearted, and you save those who are crushed in spirit. Be with those who grieve the loss of loved ones, especially with the family and friends of David Scott, husband of Deanna. Lord, be their refuge and fortress in the days ahead, and may your unfailing love through the cross and empty tomb be their comfort. Lord, in your mercy. Prince of Peace, give peace to our homes, to our classrooms, to our world. Protect those who serve in our armed forces and those who preserve order and integrity in our community. Strengthen those who teach, especially those in our school and preschool at St. John's, that they may celebrate with you the growth and achievements of their students and finish the year strongly. Grant your spirit of wisdom, your power of presence, and your assurance of reconciliation to those in need of peace, Lord, in your mercy. God, mercifully grant us times of rest, refreshment, renewal. Amid busyness, you teach us to be still and to wait in silence. Calm and quiet our souls with your peace. Give us moments of rest to renew us for the bold proclamation of your gospel, and to always be ready to listen and to share love with others in our word and deed. In the name of Jesus, we pray this. Amen. You may be seated. And I think it's time to welcome some new members into this congregation. So if you are a new member today, you get to walk up and stand on this stage facing us, and I'll go down to the bottom so everyone can see you. Come on forward, new members. And just line up all the way across. You got this. We believe in you. Oh, man, I forgot my book. It's that little red one. Will you hand me that to you? Otherwise, I won't know what to say. Perfect. Thank you. Hey, will you hold these for me and then I'll grab them for me in just a second? Sweet. Here they are. I thought you were going to clap for them. Well, like we looked at today, Jesus told the apostles they were witnesses, and they carried out their mission with great power, bearing witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And all Christians are entrusted with this mission in one way or another, for we are all called to be witnesses to Jesus in our lives and thus advance his mission, clothed with the power on high, the power of the Holy Spirit that you received in your baptism, confirmed in the faith that you confess today. And we bear witness through our words and deeds. This is what it means to be a member of St. John's, to do that joyfully, to share our faith with family members, friends, and co-workers. And today we are excited to look at you, to receive you into this congregation, and to stand alongside you, not just at the resurrection of our Lord, but in each and every day of our lives as we carry out the mission to deliver his restorative hope that we have in Jesus. So friends in Christ, the people of St. John's welcome you into membership today, so that you may walk with the body of Christ, find meaning, joy, and community in our life together. St. Paul writes, "But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. You have been instructed, and you have begun to walk with the body of Christ that is St. John's Lutheran Orange. And to hear your confession and intent and to be an active part of the body of Christ, you have presented yourself today for this joyful affirmation. So as your pastor, I now ask you, do you believe in God the Father Almighty and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit? Please answer, yes, I believe. Do you hold all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God and the doctrine of the Lutheran Church drawn from them and confessed in the small catechism to be faithful and true, just like you were taught? Please say, I do. Do you intend to live according to the word of God and in faith, word and deed, remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even to death? And do you desire to become a member of St. John's Orange and join us in all the privileges and responsibilities that come with such membership? If so, please answer, I do by the grace of God. Very good. Now it is time. When I call your name, will you come forward? And I will read a verse and give you your membership. Robert Beeman. From 1 Corinthians 1, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Victoria? Also from 1 Corinthians. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Laura Damp. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Matthew 28, verse 20. And Thomas? From Isaiah 40. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Ariane Ensley? From Isaiah 41. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Chad Kissa? From Colossians 4. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Barry McGinnis? From Isaiah chapter 12. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. The Lord himself, is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. Taya Newland? From Psalm 103. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. Julia Pays? From Romans 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Steve? From Micah chapter 6. He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Good job. Noel Posca. Where are you going? There we go. Hey, what's up? From Philippians 4. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Alexandra Pulsifer. From Isaiah 30. Yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. Therefore, he will rise up to show you compassion. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all who wait for him. And Christian McGinnis. From Lamentations. Oh, got a little snack there. From Lamentations 3. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, grant you his Spirit, the Spirit of power, the Spirit of love, the Spirit of strength and grace, and of the Word of God. Amen. We celebrate and give thanks to God for our new members today. Before you go down, it's tradition that at least one member gives a speech. I'm kidding. Let's close in prayer, and then we'll get you back to your seats. Lord God, we are witnessing your good work in the life of St. John's and this fine people. Grant us openness and willingness to reach people with your love and grace. Grant to these, our new members of the body of Christ, a new fit at St. John's and lives and habits that reflect your place in their lives. Grant us joy and grace as we all walk together in your mission, delivering the restorative hope of Jesus. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. You guys can go back to your seats.
Let's give thanks to God for our new members today. tithes and offerings as we worship him.
Good morning. I'm so glad you joined us online today. Right now, our ushers are receiving the weekly offering from our friends inside the service. This is the time in the service we acknowledge and thank the Lord for the blessings he has given us. Our health, our friends, our shelter, our education, food, so much more. It's because of him that we're able to experience all that we do on a daily and weekly basis. I encourage you at home to take a moment, just you and God, and to thank him for the blessings you experienced this week. Just open your heart to him in prayer. When you're done, please make your weekly offering online. If you're watching on your computer or mobile device, you can find a link in the description section right below the video. And if you're watching on your television or listening to the podcast, you can simply visit stjohnsorange.org/give, and that'll take you where you need to go. I wish you another blessed week, and thank you for your generosity. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Sing one more this morning before we make our way. And this piece, it allows us to make room for Jesus. And so as we sing this out, let's put on the full armor of God before we make our way so that we can continue throughout our weeks with this worship and this presence that we fall into at this moment as we praise his name. And let's sing out and come in full submission, full worship of his name. We sing.
Receive the benediction of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Head over to the courtyard, shake a new member's hand, grab a donut, then make your way over to the festival.
Yes.
Where there's even more fun. What a great day. All right.
What a
see you in a
day.
Bit.
Go in peace.